Welcome to this tutorial from the Urban Penguin. We're up to lesson 5 of learning Linux, and this week we're going to look at the GRUB bootloader. So as we start our Linux machine, we are usually presented with the GRUB bootloader. There are other bootloaders like the Linux loader, but the Grand Unified bootloader has been used now for several years, and we're going to take a look at configuring the GRUB bootloader. So we can see that it's presenting me with a menu, so I can select desktop or failsafe. Desktop, we're just selecting the VGA mode. Failsafe then has many other things. We can't boot the machine, just are in reduced video mode, less processors, avoiding power management. Floppy would then take me to boot from a floppy drive if I had, let's say, DOS or whatever on a floppy drive. So if we look here at the desktop option, it's just got the options to boot to 800 by 600. I use that for my capture software. But if we don't protect the GRUB menu, people could come along and type commands or options like this. These are just kernel options. So if I enter init equals /bin/bash, we're going to boot up just to the bash command prompt, and we don't run any of our initialization scripts. This is going to allow the machine to start up to a command-only prompt without running any services and logging me in directly as root. So let's see how this works. So I still get my splash screen, but I can hit the escape key so I can see what's happening in the background, but it will boot very quickly because we've got no services to start. We don't run any logon or profile scripts. So it's a very limited environment, but I can edit files. If I type ID, which is normally spelled with an I followed by a D, I can see that I'm in as root, and it gave me no prompt, didn't ask for a password or anything like this. So this is really quite dangerous. If we type mount, we can see we've got a read-write file system on devsda2. Again, this is not really what I want, because it's going to allow then the user who is root to edit configuration files. So I might not be able to do a lot else, because, as I say, I don't have a path statement or a library path statement. There are no services that are running. However, I can edit files, get to the password file, get to the shadow file. I could cause havoc on this machine. So, of course, the basic things like this we should look at protecting. If I try to shut the machine down, say init 6, well, I've got no path statement, there are no services, nothing's going to work. Can't even reboot my machine. So what I'm going to do is we'll clear the screen, and we're going to protect the root file system so I can power off my machine. So I'm going to run the command mount minus O, and the options I want to put in are remount, comma, RO for read only, and these are just comma separated, no additional spaces. And of course, I'm going to do this for the root file system and maybe other file systems as well, but I've only got the root file system that I particularly need to care about on this machine. It's a demonstration machine. So once there, I'm literally going to have to just power the machine off, and then we power on again, and we're going to boot up normally then into our desktop environment. And I'm going to edit the GRUB configuration so we can understand how we can control this a little bit. So as we boot up, we wait for the desktop to present it. I'm going to open up a command shell. I could use YAST, the graphical environment, to edit this, but really we need to look at how we could do it through the command files. It's going to be then standard across most distributions of Linux, and it's a lot quicker and less confusing than the graphical environment. So I'm logging in as Geeko, my standard user. open up then the graphical command shell. Just going to increase the size of the font a little bit with the control shift and equals. Of course, to gain access I'd need to be root, so I'm just going to use switch user and put in the root user's password. I'm going to use phi to edit /boot /grub/menu.lst. Looks a bit like menu first, but it's menu.lst. So this is our grub menu files. If you work with Windows, you might think it as similar to the boot ini or boot ini file. So we've got some global entries. So the default is saying the stanza or entry in the menu that it boots to. It is the first or the zeroth entry because we start from zero. The timeout, so 8 seconds. The graphical menu we're going to find on HD0, so our first hard drive. Partition number one, so the second partition. Remember, we're counting from zero. And then the file boot message. Then the default entry then is pointing to this stanza. Each stanza starts with the word title. Title would also then end it. So as soon as we see the next word title, that's going to be the end of the stanza. So the default entry points through to the desktop entry here. We're saying the root file system again is SDA2, so the first disk, second partition. We're going to look for the kernel by looking for the bootable partition. We would find that from the master boot record. And then we look for the directory boot vmlin, as in our case, because I set up the root file system to be the bootable partition. If boot, though, the directory boot, was partitioned up separately, then we would make that the bootable partition, and we would just look then for the kernel called vmlinus. So yeah, we're going to find the kernel. We've got an entry then for the root file system. So again, that could be by its kernel name, SDA2, or disk by ID, looking at its serial number. This is all one line, it's just wrapped through. So resume then is pointing through to the swap file. So this is partition number one, so SDA1. Our splash screen. And then we're showing the options after this. This is where then I see my 800 by 600 resolution VGA mode. So all of these are kernel options. As we move down, we've got then the entry for failsafe. And we don't particularly need this, so we can delete this entry. To delete an entry in Vi, if we want to delete multiple lines, we just count how many lines that we want. So I need to delete about 5 lines here, so the comment, title, root, kernel, and RAM disk. The RAM disk just contains the driver, that's the init RD, the drivers that the kernel needs to load our root file system. So once we're certain what we need to delete, we move to the top line and we just go through and issue the command 5dd. So then that deletes 5 lines. It's deleted them, they're in my paste buffer, so I could paste them in elsewhere if I wanted to. If we have a look here, we then got our entry for the floppy disk. So we're not going to verify the file system, but we're going to check then FD0 for a file system. And if we find one, we're going to look for its bootloader, and we're going to load that. This could be loading into Windows, maybe on another partition or another disk. Move up here, I could just hit P to paste the entry in if I wanted to move the entry that I'd added for failsafe. Remember, if I paste it here, it's then going to be entry 0, so it would become my default entry. So just P, paste my buffer back in. I'm going to hit insert now and put in the password. So I'm going to protect my grub menu with a password. We'll put that password as secret. If you don't like the idea of plain text passwords though, it doesn't have to stay here in plain text. So let's just jump out of our file for the moment. So I'll save my changes. And if I type the word grub and tab tab or double tab, we then see all of the commands in our path statement that start with grub. And we can see one there, grub-md5-crypt. I'll give you three guesses as to what you think that command might do. So as we type it, it prompts for the password. Type in a password. Again, this could be any password, but it's just creating then an MD5 encrypted version of it. I can just copy there and paste it in then as my password. So we'll just go back into Vi. I can then, because this is in a graphical shell, I can just right click and paste once I'm in the insert mode. Obviously take the word secret out. If I just left it like this, yeah, Grub would want me to type in the encrypted password, so that's not a good idea, is it? We have to tell Grub that this is an encrypted password, and we do that with --MD5. So we should be up and ready now. We've protected our grub file now with a password. We'll need to know the password if we want to put in any additional boot options that are not part of our menu. So once we're ready, we hit escape. And then to save the changes, it's colon and exit. And now we're ready to reboot our machine. But rather than just run the reboot command or init 6, we could do something like shutdown, and shutdown minus R would be for a reboot, shutdown minus H would be to power off or halt. The advantage of this, I can put a time. I want to say now, but then I could schedule a shutdown or a reboot or specify for however many minutes. So this is more useful in your own environment. So once we then start booting, we will boot into a non-graphical environment. We don't have the graphical grub menu. There's no option for me to put any extra entries in without putting in the password. So I can hit P on the entry I want to edit. Type in the password. So that's of course is just the clear text password. We've got the encrypted version stored. And now edit the entry that I want to make changes to. So here we're just looking at the failsafe entry. Just move my arrow along to see the rest of the entries. I can then escape to get back. Again, edit to make any changes to the desktop entry. I'm not going to make any changes, so again, escape will take me back out. And B to boot into this operating system. Of course, I don't have to edit any of these entries. I could just hit enter on the menu. But let's look at going back into our menu file. So we will this time delete the entry for the failsafe mode, and we'll create a new entry so we can boot both to the graphical environment and the command line environment. So to go to run level 5 and run level 3 from our menu. So again, we're just gaining some root privileges, just using Control R to search my history. And of course, this is what I want to edit. So I'm going to delete the entries for failsafe. So 5DD. Oops, 5DD. So just a dd deletes the extra line and you type 4. And now I'm going to copy these lines. But first of all, let's just change this to desktop GUI. And then we'll copy these lines down. So again, I need to yank them out, so 4yy, and then paste, and we'll change the stanza name or title for this one to command line, and to go to the command line we're just going to put the kernel option 3 for run level 3. And change the title to desktop CLI. So the default run level is run level 5. So in the desktop CLI, we're moving away from the default run level and specifying the run level just by its number, number 3. So the kernel options are just space separated. We save the file with escape and colon exit. And then I can just go exclamation mark S because I know the last command that I type beginning with S was shutdown minus R. So of course our system's going to reboot. We should be able to see now the entries for desktop GUI and desktop CLI. The CLI has the additional boot options. We still of course got our non-graphical boot menu. But I don't have to make any changes to any of these, just choose CLI and hit enter. So the password is only needed if I need to change the boot options. If I don't need to change them, I just boot up with the enter key or allowing the default options to load. So as the system now boots up, it will take me to the command line only prompt. So this is run level 3. We're presented with the login command and we just put in our username and password as normal. So we can log in as Geeko, chuck in Geeko's password, and look, we've been able to changed the grub menu, protect it with a password. All of this was maintained through the /boot/grub menu.lst, and we've seen how we can add entries, remove entries, and put password entries into the grub menu. Thank you for your time, and do hope to see you again next week.